Good afternoon, everybody. This is Shannon Scott, the Bard of Bonaventure, coming from deep inside the South in Savannah, Georgia, inside a beautiful, beautiful Bonaventure Cemetery. It's a little cloudy today, but we like these overcast days sometimes. Really brings out some other kinds of feeling in Bonaventure and cemeteries. And let's say the shade, I don't know, just a different texture, different vibe. But I wanted to talk about the Egyptian obelisk being in family plots. 9 times out of 10, you can pretty much bank on an obelisk being symbolic of not just kind of like an artistic trend, although certainly that's an element, no doubt. It's art, obviously. But it has a lot to do with the history of Freemasonry and also the statement of the Masons. There are 4 45-footers in Bonaventure Cemetery that sit where some of the high officers of one of the local lodges, and maybe the most significant historical lodge in a way, are buried. And these sit perfectly due north, is my understanding. Freemasons have come out here and measure these and talk about how it's amazing that they got solid granite like this to stand so directly due north. And essentially, they are symbolic of a single ray of sunlight pointing to Ra, the light, the sun, the original feeling of love in the universe, and in a lot of ways how that light points back to you. And let's say the journey of love inside of yourselves is an energy. So, you know, there are a lot of ways to interpret this, even through the Masonic tradition, obviously, but it is the original symbol of monotheism, single deity worship. And in my own interpretation, my own impression, it does also represent like the birth of individualism as a concept in the history of the human timeline. And I think most Masons probably recognize, you know, the meanings of that stuff in the way that they embrace their own discipline spiritually. It doesn't necessarily mean every Mason does, but I think that's kind of a general attitude because a lot of Masons are churchgoers and vice versa. Even Christendom kind of adopted it during the Crusades. It was seen as a sort of light that you could use to defend the ideals of monotheism and Christendom. And by the way, this was cut in Elberton, Georgia, the granite capital of the world. And yeah, granite was the choice stone of the pharaohs. So how kind of nicely elite is that tie-in? But these were also cut in Elberton, Georgia in the 19th and one or two of these out here, I think, early 20th century. But they were put on barges at the mouth of the Savannah River in Augusta, Georgia. And I've seen photographs of this one and one other coming down the Savannah River on barges by themselves. And let me tell you, nothing modern about that photograph. It's like a snapshot of the ancient Nile. You see a muddy river, a tree embankment in the distance, and like a wooden barge with an obelisk. Snapshot of the ancient Nile. But because we're a mile from the ocean and hurricane winds are a relative, somebody, and also earthquakes, somebody had to stabilize these. And so in this case, it was William Kehoe, the iron industrialist, I believe. He and his crew drilled a hole through this thing so perfectly it would allow it to stand straight up and down and be a snug fit for an earthquake rod of iron 150 feet long. So from that pyramid point, run over 100 feet beneath the monument, is a stabilizing rod of iron. And as the Masons did give us the foundation of architecture through algebra and geometry, the foundations anyway, there's no escaping the encoded mysticism of their math. 45 feet is that nod to the unit of measurement used in the building of Solomon's Temple. So yeah, the statement in a way from the Rowers, Cunningham family, is that they were great builders of their communities, earthly lives, spiritual lives, business lives, on down the line. And incidentally, the Rowers family had a factory brewery here in the city, which I believe was selling millions and millions of dollars worth of beer in the 19th century. So yeah, they had a pretty deep checkbook, I guess, to buy something like this and to get it order made and all and brought here. Their plot is also kind of shield shaped, so it's like a sword and a shield expression here, with like little Byzantine Christian watchtowers as turrets at the entrance. So yeah, there's a lot of Christendom meaning here too, with maybe kind of like a Knight of the Templar vibe at the same time. But yeah, that is the Rowers obelisk or obelisk. And it's interesting too that obelisks in the 19th century ran almost neck and neck with some Christian cemeteries in terms of the Christian cross relative, and not everybody was happy about that. There were sometimes events where little church ladies got together and they sewed banners and they stood in the cemeteries protesting that such a pagan era object would be raised so mightily across a Christian burial space. And yeah, I mean, if you really get down to the brass tacks of the competitiveness maybe between Christian faith and the Masonic discipline, it can get a little fuzzy. I'll just put it that way and leave it at that. But anyway, guys, I hope you enjoyed that from the Bard of Bonaventure, Shannon Scott, here in Bonaventure Cemetery. I'm out here pretty much 6 days a week, but I have guys out here 7 days a week at 10 a.m., noon, and 2 p.m., learning you and the rest of the world about all these kind of neat details about Bonaventure and, let's say, the world that's connected to the cemetery and the world beyond the cemetery. But nonetheless, you can check me out at BonaventureCemetery.com, ShannonScott.com, BonaventureCemeteryJourneys.com. I'm also on Facebook under Bonaventure Official and also Bonaventure Cemetery Journeys. And again, don't forget to subscribe, share, and like. And of course, if there's something that you want to hear about specifically, feel free to leave a comment in the comment section below. But it's been my pleasure storying you guys. And this is your Storyist signing off from Bonaventure.